'Tis all a checkerboard of nights and days, where destiny with men for pieces plays.
The words of an 11th century Persian, Omar Khayyam. In the West, his poetry made him a household name.
It became the most famous book of poetry in the English language.
Americans immediately embraced the Rubaiyat.
Omar Khayyam's right to move and finger rights and having writ moves on.
Nor all your piety nor wit shall lure it back to cancel half a line.
Zendikiko. Katrin don't do it.
But he was also a formidable scientist.
I think his greatest achievement in astronomy was to get an incredibly accurate measurement for the length of the tropical year.
And a calendar so accurate it is still in use today. This is the story of an intellectual giant whose legacy stretches into the 21st century. I've always been attracted to his poetry and his philosophy. Now I'm going on a journey to find out more about Omar Khayyam and his place in the world today. Abulfat Omar ibn Ibrahim Khayyam was born in Persia in the city of Nishabur in 1048 in the province of Khorasan. Here, East met West on the Silk Route and the gateway to the ancient civilizations of China and India. The original city was destroyed by a series of earthquakes and later by the Mongol invasion. Only the remains of medieval Nishabur exist today.
What kind of city was Nishabur?
It's a very large city. I think no one can say quite how large, but by the standards I would have thought of any city in Europe at the period except Constantinople.
In 1040, Persia was invaded from the east by nomadic tribal Turks known as the Seljuks. They defeated the existing rulers and made Nishabur the first capital of their new empire.
They came in substantial but not overwhelming numbers. They came already converted to Islam. They knew what cities and settled agriculture were like, they did not come to destroy.
At the time of Omar Khayyam, the ruling king Malik Shah and his chief minister Nizam al-Mulk opened colleges across the empire. Most important were the Nizamiye, where some of the finest scholars impressed young minds. Omar Khayyam was one such student.
What kind of ruler was Malik Shah? Do we know much about him?
His period of rule is a kind of partnership between the great Persian bureaucrat and the Seljuk ruler. Omar Khayyam comes to court and becomes a very close intimate of Malik Shah. The word used for such courtiers is Nadim, and Omar Khayyam is clearly that. And it's not just that he's a nice person to have a drink with, but because he has skills and knowledge that are of value to the ruler.
His universal sentiments made Khayyam popular in the West. In the summer of 2009, academics and scholars from across the world gathered at the University of Cambridge to celebrate Omar Khayyam. At the post-conference garden party, I meet Sir Nicholas Barrington, a trustee of the Ancient India and Iran Trust. The man who made Omar Khayyam's poetry famous in the West was a reclusive man of letters, Edward Fitzgerald, whose circle of friends included literary giants Alfred Lord Tennyson and William Makepeace Thackeray.
Fitzgerald came from a very wealthy Anglo-Irish family, and it's said that his parents were some of the richest people in England. And he had a privileged and, so to speak, rather idle life. He went to Cambridge, and he never had a job, never had a profession. He was what the Victorians would have recognized as a bachelor. The main emotional center of his life was friendship, almost always with men. And he became friends with a young, self-taught linguist called Edward Cowell. And he knew Cowell when he was in his late 30s, and Cowell was 18 or 19.
Edward Cowell was studying classics at Oxford when he came across a rare manuscript of Persian poetry in the Bodleian Library. It's still there today, and I'm looking forward to seeing it.
So, Robert, is this the book which Edward Fitzgerald translated into English?
Yes, it is the actual manuscript that he used for his translation.
This little book?
Yes.
Oh, yeah, I can see here. It's written in Persian, Hakim Umar Khayyam. So is this book, as far as you're concerned, in good condition now?
It's in very good condition for its age, considering that it was produced in about 1460.
1460?
Yes.
So it's,
yes.
This is about 550 years old.
Yes, yes.
Robert, I can see one of the rubaiyat here, which is one of my favorites.
Yes.
در کارگاه کوزگری رفتم دوش دیدم 2000 کوزه گویا و خموش ناگاه یکی کوزه برآورد خروش کو کوزگر و کوزه خر و کوزه فروش. I, to be honest with you, I don't know how Fitzgerald managed to translate this into English. I mean, if you ask me what he says, I can't translate it for you.
Really?
Yeah. Honestly, yeah. In the middle of the 19th century, how Fitzgerald, with his limited Persian, was able to translate this into English and makes Rubaiyat one of the most famous books in the world, I don't know how he did that. He must have been a genius.
Soon after finding Umar Khayyam's manuscript, Cowell moved to India.
A few months after Cowell left England for Calcutta, Fitzgerald made his brief and disastrous marriage. He married a woman called Lucy Barton, who was the daughter of an old friend of his. The translation of the Rubaiyat belongs to this period in which Fitzgerald is, so to speak, doubly afflicted, first by the departure of Edward Cowell for India, and then by the trauma, if you like, of his marriage.
'Tis all a checkerboard of nights and days, where destiny with men for pieces plays. Hither and thither moves and mates and slays, and one by one back in the closet lays.
In this bleak frame of mind, Fitzgerald began to translate Umar Khayyam's Rubaiyat. And like many saints, he found a kindred spirit in this 11th century Persian.